Hey, what's that out in the distance? Is it a bird? Is it a plane? Oh no, it's an alien planet on a crash collision course with Earth. And that spells only one thing. Life on Earth is about to get really, really bad and also really, really hot. Well, that goes without saying really, doesn't it? But if two great celestial bodies collided anywhere in the universe, the impact alone would be cataclysmic on a cosmic scale and devastating to the solar system for eons to come. But what if it was our cute little pale blue dot? And what if I was to tell you it may have already happened before? Well, hold on to your crash helmets because this ride's about to get a little bit bumpy. Hello internet, what's going on? And once again, welcome back to the most inquisitive channel on YouTube, Life's Biggest Questions. As per usual, I'll be your disembodied floating voice, Jack Finch, as today we curiously ask the question, what if Earth smashed into another planet? Roll the clip. For the curious amongst you, that clip was from the wholly depressing 2011 film Melancholia by Lars von Trier because, well, yeah, if Earth smashed into another planet, it would be pretty damn depressing for everyone and everything involved, right? Yeah. Exactly. It illustrates a pretty telling physical response though, because cinema has done a relatively stand-up job of depicting what our sky would look like with another planet looming above us. And if it indeed was on a collision course primed to smash straight into us, all we could really do is grab our loved ones, hold them closely, and hope that we get swallowed by some kind of Deus Ex Machina portal to another dimension. Because it would be bad. Like, really, really bad. How do we know that? Well, because of a little thing called the giant impact hypothesis. Let me explain. Have you ever looked up at the moon and thought, hey little guy, where did you come from? Well, back in 1898, a scientist named George Darwin, as in, yes, the son of our boy Charlie Darwin, hypothesized that the Earth and the Moon were once a single celestial body, and that a proto-molten moon had been creatively spun out of the ejecta from the Earth because of centrifugal forces. Well, he was definitely onto something, but it wasn't until 1975 when doctors William K. Hartman and Donald R. Davis proposed that the moon was a result of our Earth colliding with a planet-sized body, the collision of which caused the ejecta to gradually coalesce and form the moon. And they may have been bang on the money. Because the fact is that whole event would have taken a pretty massive celestial body, probably something at least the size of Mars. Well, in fact, that hypothetical protoplanet just so happens to have a title, Theia, named after the mythological Greek titan who gave birth to the moon goddess Selene. Funny how those things work, eh? Well, the components are already there, so let's see precisely how they hypothetically played out. We know that our Earth was born around 4.5 billion years ago, which although sounds like a long, long time, the fact is it isn't comparative to the age of our universe. During that time though, embryonic planets and proto-worlds were a dime a dozen floating around, hitting into things, ready to find their own way in the universe. One of those was our special little planet, Earth, doing its thing, trying its best to keep a lid on all the bubbling soup of life below. And then along comes Theia, spinning and spinning, and then boom, she hits us like a bat out of hell. And in that hypothesized instance, we can imagine exactly what life would be like on Earth today if another planet came hurtling at us from the deep void of space. Let's call that planet, oh, I don't know, something sinister like Ultron. If Ultron was roughly the same size as our planet, like Theia, and somehow fell out of the void of space toward Earth, by the time it was visible in the sky, as in the same size as the sun or moon, we'd have roughly several weeks before it impacted us, based on the same scale as Earth's escape velocity, which is roughly 11 kilometers per second. In those several weeks, could we do anything to prevent our imminent extinction? Nah, pretty much nothing, actually, save the hope of somehow slapping together enough rockets to blast us all the way to Mars and continue the species. But hey, that sounds like a challenge worth taking, right? For the most part though, we'd have a few weeks to slowly witness our demise coming ever closer and closer. I mean, I wouldn't really want to paint the picture on what kind of globally depressing environment that would create, but imagine that you're sat at a really awkward dinner table, except everyone on Earth is there and everyone's really, really sad. I mean, I imagine that some of us would light bonfires on the beaches, dancing around in a bright burst and a lust for life, shouting out into the cosmic void that, hey, we existed, if not for a short time, but hey, we were here. Human beings. For the most part though, yeah, it would suck. Once the clock had finally run down though, for a few split seconds before impact, we'd witness the planet Ultron up close and personal, and it would terrifyingly fill our sky from one side of the horizon to the other. That is, if you're lucky enough to be on the side of the Earth that witnessed the point of impact. Because a few nanoseconds before impact, both planets' collective atmospheres would glow brightly as they were suddenly cataclysmically compressed. In those last few moments, you'd be atomically vaporized by the heat and light released from the impact, and you definitely wouldn't be smushed to death by some alien rock face. However, if you were on the other side of the planet, you'd have very little warning about how messed up things are about to get for you. Suddenly, you'd have to deal with the ground beneath you turning into an unpredictable trampoline made of rock and molten magma, with the motivation of slinging you off into the atmosphere. If you didn't realize, that's a very bad thing also, due to the fact that you can't breathe in space and you'd have nowhere left to go. All of that smashed up Earth would need to go somewhere though, and due to a little scientific function known as a Roche limit, the resulting ejecta as well as its atmosphere would be loosely kept inside the Earth's gravitational field, but would also be kept inside Ultron's new gravity, and for a moment, the world's gravity would suddenly be pointing sideways. That means, yeah, you know that new treehouse you just built? See you later. What a waste of time. But all jokes aside, all life on Earth would end, because we have to point back to the giant impact hypothesis, where our moon was created from a devastating collision with the protoplanet Theia. In all likelihood though, if we added Ultron to the equation, we'd more than likely end up with another moon, or maybe even several from the massively ejected ejecta. So, hey, that's pretty cool, right? Although, we wouldn't be around to see it. What a bummer. Well, I'm a little bit perturbed, guys, so there we have it, our bittersweet answer to what if Earth smashed into another planet. What about you guys? How do you see it? Why don't you let us know your thoughts down in the comment section below? Before we depart, though, let's take a quick look at some of your more resounding remarks from over the past few days. First up, Joshua Summerton says, I like the life's biggest questions when Jack Finch is answering the question. And hey, Joshua Summerton, cheers, my good buddy. That's very nice of you. Always nice to hear some kind remarks. Why don't you just keep questioning? Yeah, I only put this in here to give myself a boost for today. Thanks, Josh. Next up, Rishikesh Mahal says, I don't know why, sad face, but I like your videos much. Happy face. And hey, Rishikesh Mahal, boy, that was one rollercoaster of emotion, but I'm glad you ended it on a positive note. Cheers, buddy. Keep sticking around for some more life's biggest questions. On that note, folks, unfortunately, that's all we've got time for in today's video. Cheers for sticking around all the way until the end. If you're a fan of this video, make sure to hit that thumbs up button as well as that subscribe button, and I'll be seeing you in the next one. As per usual, I've been your disembodied floating voice, Jack Finch. You've been watching Life's Biggest Questions, and until next time, you take it easy.